Hello and welcome to another episode of The Sound of Money. In today's episode, we meet Mr. Praveen Kadle, who has had an amazing experience and association with the Tatas for over three decades. Apart from the Tata experience, he talks about his career, his start or liftoff of career with the Garhwaris. Well, he has in him the ability, the true leadership quality, which he talks about very easily all through the show, be it the Daewoo Motor Company deal or the Jaguar Land Rover deal or even listing on NYSE. All that exposure, that experience that he had in various roles as MD, CEO for on the Tata group of companies, all that and the challenges that he faced, all that comes up in the next episode of The Sound of Money.
Of Money with Santosh Sirur.
Hello and welcome to a very special episode of The Sound of Money. Now, in our episodes on Sound of Money, we've been talking about financial literacy, policy and macroeconomics, and even about banking trends. But starting today, we also talk about another facet of banking and finance, which is leadership. And when it comes to leadership, I have an amazing guest on my show. And I wanted to start my show on leadership with him, and he agreed very easily. I have with me on the Sound of Money, Mr. Praveen Kadle. Now, Mr. Kadle has been associated with the Tata Group for almost three decades. Currently, he's the chairman of Tata Components, and he's been associated, as I said, with Tata's right from Tata IBM, which was a joint venture, and he was the CFO then. Then he was also, the executive director later on in 2001 with the board of Tata Motors. And he has done some very, very pivotal role when it came to Tata Motors. And in fact, in almost all the Tata organizations that he has been associated with. And one of them being in 2008 when the Tatas re-entered into the financial services through Tata Capital. We're going to talk all about this, his experiences, his rich, experiences that came from the ground, and especially when it came to turning around industries, sectors in the Tata Group. But more importantly, I'm going to talk to him about something very intriguing, which is about his email ID. But first, let me welcome our guest, Mr. Kadle. Mr. Praveen Kadle, welcome to The Sound of Money.
Thank you, and good morning.
Yes. Mr. Kadle, I was quite intrigued with the email ID when we started corresponding for this episode. And I did read Prachita's Capital, and it was not Tata's or, something on that lines. So what exactly is Prachita's Capital? I'm very keen to know about this.
So Prachita's is basically a Sanskrit word. And mm-hmm. as you know, Sanskrit is the original language of India. So I was doing some research on the And I was in terms of finding the right name for this company, which I just started. Mm-hmm. And I came across this word called Prachetas. And the meaning of Prachetas is an intelligent investor, careful and intelligent investor, rather. Sorry, it's not investor, careful and intelligent person. And the theme of my company and the main strategy of the company is to make investments. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to give the confidence to the people that we will be very careful and make the investments in a very intelligent manner and in a careful manner mm-hmm. so that the investors can get very good returns. So instead of choosing any other word, I thought I would choose this word Prachetas. Mm-hmm. Of course, it brings the linkage with the original language of India, which is the Sanskrit word.
Yeah.
And our theme of this company is basically supporting the nation in whatever small way we can do. I mean, I don't have any big kind of goals, or I don't want to be very, very ambitious kind of make ambitious statements. But what I would like to say is that the country is in a very, very advantageous position right now. And in my personal view and in the view of my colleagues, India should grow significantly in the post-COVID situation. Mm-hmm. And therefore, whatever I can do in our own little way, so we should do it in terms of providing the capital to the industries which are very pivotal and important from the point of view of India's future growth strategy.
Okay.
And therefore, I was looking at something which is, in terms of the name, which is linked to the original language of India, which is Sanskrit, and making investments in a very careful and intelligent manner.
Mm-hmm.
And I came across this word, and therefore I chose this word.
Interesting. So are you saying you're foraying into private equity? It's an amazing world out there. And that's one. And the second question is, what about your role with the Tatas? Is that somewhere linked? Or how do you want to take this forward from your own future and career standpoint?
Yes, to answer your first question, I do want to enter into private equity.
Mm-hmm.
I started private equity in Tata Capital right from its inception in 2008. Of course, after the preliminary work and whatever groundwork we had to do, it was, I think, in 2009-10 that we started. And the actual start, as I said, happened in 2009-10. And we made some good investments, we got very good returns. So I was fascinated by this industry, not because of the returns and carry and management fees, which are very, very popularly associated and many a times highly criticized by the critics of private equity,
mm-hmm.
but for the reason of the real contribution the private equity players can make in terms of their own contribution through their companies to the growth of the country. And of course, in the process, they make money. That's a separate issue.
Yeah.
And I am not a socialist. And therefore, I'm not, afraid of talking about capitalism or making good gains, provided all of this is done for the right cause of the growth of industry, growth of the country. Plus, of course, I also believe that the companies should contribute to the society. And therefore, they have contribution in terms of social, being a kind of a responsible social kind of a entity. And therefore, I felt I should continue to carry that same interest that I had in private equity in my personal career,
mm-hmm.
which I am now starting from 1st April 2021. Your second question, what is my role with Tata Group? Yes, I have now moved into a non-executive role in Tata Group.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm on the board of a couple of companies in a non-executive capacity, including the company you talked about as the chairman of Tata AutoComm Systems.
Mm-hmm.
So which is a privately held company and it's there in the auto component as well as in the related component industry.
Okay, that's really very interesting to know. It's your next step, and I'm sure it's an amazing way ahead for you. So coming to the leadership, right? You have been known in the Tata Group and otherwise as the change magician, right? For example, not even before Tata's, right? Your experience with Garhwa Aerobs, where the organization from a 6 crore turnover, I guess 1984 to 75 crores in 1990, and I'm talking of the mid 80s to 90s, when India was turning around slowly, even before the major economic liberalization. So how, from that experience to Land Rover, Jaguar, to turn it around with Daewoo, how has been that experience, and what is very important when it comes to such structural changes from your perspective?
I think I must honestly at the outset say that I was lucky because I got two key industrialists in my life right from the beginning of my career life. So first was the late Mr. B.D. Garhwa, who was the founder chairman of the Garhwa Group. I was, I think, 27 or so when I started working with him initially, mm-hmm. as an executive assistant, and I don't know the reason, but he must have liked me. Then he asked me to manage this company called, at that time, it was called Garhwale Ballrooms.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a small company, as you said, 6 or 7 crores turnover. And maybe I was lucky, as I said, in terms of getting some good export orders. Even in the domestic business, we started doing well. And the company grew significantly. Of course, mm-hmm. in those years, when we talk about 6-7 crores to around 70-75 crores, was small, but still the growth was quite phenomenal.
Yeah, yeah.
And more than the growth in terms of the turnover, we also made very good profits consistently.
Mm-hmm.
So and it was a great experience in terms of building the export business. 40% of our production was exported.
Yeah.
We created a 100% export-oriented unit. We got into some of the interesting other technical fiber-related projects, which have held the company very well going forward. And even now, that company is getting significant benefits out of the diversification that we made.
Mm-hmm.
And that helped me a lot in terms of getting the leadership skills in way back. This was before the liberalization, which was initiated by Dr. Manmohan Singh and Narasimha Rao in 1991.
Yeah.
I then got moved into Tata Group then. End of 1990, the late chairman, Mr. B.D. Garhwale, expired. And I got an offer to join the joint venture, which was being set up by Tata's along with IBM.
Mm-hmm.
And this was the first clearance given by the then FIPB.
Okay. The Investment Promotion Board.
The board, Foreign Investment Promotion Board. And this was the first project which was cleared by the FIPB. And I got an offer to join them as a CFO. So completely different industry, from a petrochemical downstream processing industry to getting into IT, which was going to be the future of India. As you all know, what has happened in India in the IT industry, the IT engineering services industry or IT services industry. And now we are talking about digital economy and digital technology business. So I was again lucky to get the break. And this is where I joined, and I became the leadership team member of the local team. I think all the members of that leadership team were from IBM. I was the only person who was non-IBM.
Mm-hmm.
The industry was new. The whole terminology, the way of doing business, highly professional, maybe somewhat bureaucratic, because it was a global company and you needed approvals from all the global offices.
Yeah.
But still, it was a very interesting experience. I understood the discipline of financial planning, financial budgeting, in terms of also I kind of got a significant exposure to HR and HR practices. Mm-hmm. IBM was always known for the best HR practices. And because I was initially kind of I was given initially the responsibilities of finance being a CFO, but the HR also started reporting to me.
Okay.
Then as the luck would have it, my boss at that time, an American called Mike Klein,
mm-hmm.
and he was a veteran from IBM. And he said, because that's the time when we started assembling the personal computers, the IBM personal computers, which then subsequently they sold to Lenovo. So they were planning to set up a manufacturing unit. So Mr. Mike Klein said that he would like me to take the responsibility.
Yeah.
So I said, I'm not a technical guy.
Mm-hmm.
But in India, in those days, as you know, there were so many commercial taxes, octroi duty, sales tax, whatever taxes you were talking about. And he said, this is basically excise duty, customs, and so on and so forth. And he said that manufacturing in India is basically managing this whole tax environment. Anyway, HR is reporting to you.
Yeah.
And you're a commercial guy, so you can also do a very good job in terms of managing the whole what in the IBM days, in those days, it was called as order fulfillment group.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So, and anyway, he said, it's nothing but screwdriver technology. Everything will be brought in and it will be assembled. This is screwdriver technology. And there was a very senior engineer who came with a lot of experience. He said, Venkat was his name. He said, he will report to you.
Mm-hmm.
That's how my journey started. So we selected the place in Pondicherry. It offered some good, they offered us some good land and tax concessions where they were there in those days. And so that was another great experience. So I would say it was really fun working in this joint venture with IBM.
Okay.
I mean, I learned a lot thanks to the IBM systems and processes. Okay. It was hard work, no doubt. When we were setting up the processes, you had to have a call early morning at 4 o'clock in the morning because somebody from Australia would be there and somebody from USA will be there on the other hand. And somebody will be there in the Europe or something like that.
Yeah.
So it was, but I was young. I was maybe 34, 35 years old, 36 years old. It was great fun learning, working from people from all over the globe.
Yeah.
And, but I enjoyed it.
Indeed, indeed, of course. So, you know, what I realized as you're mentioning about this experience. So normally we say, right, opportunities knock on the door, but it looks like in your case, opportunities actually barged in. So you just took it as it came, right, all through your career. So what is that one or two learnings you feel, you know, you could share with our audience? What is it that's very key for any individual when it comes to shaping up a career?
It's a difficult to answer, but let me try. First of all, as I said, if I really see my journey, I moved from one industry to another with no correlation with each other.
Mm-hmm.
So the first thing was to understand the industry. So I did study. I'm not an engineer, but whatever I could read in terms of IT or computer or whatever I had to read, I tried to read it to increase or improve my knowledge base.
Yeah.
Which I did it again subsequently when I went to the auto industry or auto component industry.
Mm-hmm.
So that was the first thing. I think the learning is important thing. The second thing was I was a good listener. So I would listen to all the people, all the viewpoints. And there are, you come across all types of people who will talk very aggressively, put forth their points, and they would like their viewpoint to be accepted and executed.
Yeah.
You also come across people who would talk with a lot of meaning and very clear thought process.
Mm-hmm.
So dealing with different people, watching them, trying to understand what they said, then get into my own zone and then think about what they were talking about, what this gentleman was talking about, what would be the implications. So that was the second thing. The third thing, of course, I kind of, and I'm talking more with reference to IBM, and I can also talk about my first experience in Garhwale Waldorf, because in both these companies, I was fairly young. I was at the age of 34, 35, became the CFO of Tata IBM. Mm-hmm. And everybody was looking at me because all the IBMers were very senior people. And so in a way, age was against me or age was also in favor of me. So I could go to the seniors and seek their views, seek their experience, seek their feedback. And they would say, because I would go with an open mind and not try to show off my position in this company. And I must say that in those days, and I'm talking about 90s, early 90s, mid 90s, India and China were identified as the growth countries by IBM, like many other Western countries had identified. So all the attention was there from IBM senior team. Right from Mr. Lou Gerstner. Lou Gerstner was the chairman at that time of IBM. Mm-hmm. Right from his office, there were at least a couple of senior people who used to visit us regularly.
Mm-hmm.
And they were quite senior. They had worked across the globe. Mm-hmm. They had huge amount of experience. And they knew the industry very well. So working with them, spending time with them, I learned a lot.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know what they say, that you need to be a learner or a student throughout your life.
Yeah.
I accepted it, and that I believe very strongly in that statement.
True.
That helped me a lot.
Mm.
The other thing is maybe working with Mr. Garwari,
yeah.
You know, who kind of imbibed me in me some basic desi, you can call it, you know, old principles of desi management. You know, you should do this way, you should behave like this, you should. He in fact treated me like his grandson. So every evening he used to call me at his residence.
Uh-huh.
You know, I worked with him for 7.5 years, and unless I was traveling, I would be at his home at 4:45 in the evening,
yeah,
or in the afternoon, and uh-huh. would be there with him till 6 o'clock or 6:30 in the evening every day without wow. fail.
Mm-hmm.
And he would ask me to tell him about what happened during the day, and then he would tell me, "Oh, this is right," or in yeah. some cases he would say, "If I were there, I would have handled it in this particular manner."
Mm.
So this was a great learning experience, and that has helped me throughout.
Okay.
So while I worked in Tata Group for 31 years so far,
yeah,
but those 7.5 years with the late B.D. Garwari were very, very useful years that I spent with him.
Okay.
And it's literally like what they say in the old Indian Gurukul kind of a system,
yeah,
where you actually sit with your guru and
yeah.
learn.
Yeah,
that's
true.
Why
absolutely. Yeah. So, you know, you brought another very interesting, and especially when it comes to leadership, I think, and especially future leaders, it's very important, the concept of mentorship, right? And that's exactly what I guess Abhasaheb Garwari did try, you know, to imbibe in you. And, you know, you guys really interacted very well. So how important is mentorship from a leadership standpoint, if you may ask you?
Okay. As a senior industry person, you can say age-wise, I'm not talking about
yeah,
experience.
Yeah. Not even age, actually. Yeah. Yeah.
So I can say that earlier as a mentee and now as a mentor, I believe that mentorship plays an important role.
Mm.
And so you come across now, you know, I'm now playing the role of a mentor, let's say.
Mm.
So I have come across all types of people.
Mm.
And most of them are very intelligent, highly studied, and what should I say? Highly studied and with good experience and all that. But temperamentally, each person is different.
Yeah.
And so my job in first place is to understand what are the strengths and weaknesses in that person.
Mm.
I think without claiming too much or talking too much about myself, I think God has given me some strengths in understanding the people and their personalities.
Mm-hmm.
And so in a way, I'm a silent observer. I keep watching each person and try to understand the personalities.
Yeah.
And that helps me a lot in terms of choosing the right people for the right job.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe eliminating people who kind of may or may not be the right people.
True.
And not throw them out of the organization, but give yeah. them jobs which are in line with their strengths.
True.
So yeah. coming back to the mentoring part, this has helped me a lot in mm. terms of, and then I do, I think maybe whatever Abhasaheb Garwari did it with me, I'm trying to kind of do the same thing in my own way. And working with Mr. Tata, since I'm just bringing it fast forward and
yeah,
talking
yeah.
about Mr.
Yeah.
I worked with him for almost close to 25 years.
Mm.
In fact, if I were to talk about 91, he was the chairman of Tata IBM. So if I include that, so you can say it's almost close to 25, 26 years that I worked with him.
Yeah.
And what I observed him was, he was exactly opposite of Abhasaheb Garwari. He will speak very briefly.
Mm-hmm.
He will tell you about this. This is what he's, and in fact, he will never order. His typical words would be, "I would be very happy if
okay
if
very this nice can be way done. To put it. Please do it. Yeah.
So it is like, I'm not ordering.
Yeah.
But when somebody like Mr. Ratan Tata is telling you, it's very clear that he would be done.
Yeah.
And then from time to time, you will go back to him and you will find that he had kind of on any subject. Even he always used to tell, I'm not a finance expert. But even when you would go to him and talk about some financial matters or finance matters or commercial matters, he would very quickly come to a point which perhaps you had not thought through.
Yeah.
So I think these are things which I learned a lot from two stalwarts.
Yeah.
Okay. The Garhwale group was not as big as Abbasaheb Garhwale, as not big as say, Tata group. But as I mentioned in the beginning, Desi management style had its own positives. I learned a lot. And that's what I value and cherish a lot.
Okay.
What I learned from.
Yeah, as you said, right, you got some fantastic opportunity that came along through your career, right, from Daewoo, maybe up to Tata Land Rover, Jaguar deals, even listing of Tata Motors on New York Stock Exchange, some of the most iconic landmarks, I would say, for Tatas, and of course, in your own career. How have these experiences helped you, and how, where, if you look back, what do you feel about it, if you can share with our audience?
I don't give much importance to the position I got. I was one of the youngest board members on the company of the board. But these are some of the things which happened. And then I got recognition because of the work that happened in Tata Motors. But it gave me very fulfilling experience. As I mentioned, Mr. Tata was, he would delegate everything.
Yeah.
So he gave a, I mean, Tata Motors, even in those days when I went, was 10,000 crore turnover company.
Mm-hmm.
I'm talking about 1996. So, it was a big canvas in any way.
Yeah.
And he would never really kind of call you every day. And unlike in the case of Mr. Garhwale, who would call me every day and I'll spend about at least 2 hours with him every day. There was nothing like that with Mr. Tata. First of all, yes, no doubt, Tata Motors was his first kind of a preferred company. And he used to spend a lot of time in Tata Motors, but still, he was the chairman of the group. And he had a lot of other international, what should I say, responsibilities or assignments. So he was on various boards, either as a board member or in advisory capacity, or all his philanthropic work would kind of give little time for us to interact with him. But still, I think whatever time we spent, whatever big canvas he gave, helped us a lot. And so when I joined Tata Motors in, it was called Telco at that time in 96, the company was 10,000 crore, reported the first time the private sector company crossed the turnover of 10,000 crores, good profit. But the it was at that stage, it had still not gone into the passenger vehicle business. It was still a strong commercial vehicle business company. Had huge market share, but the market share was slowly coming down. And as usually happens, you become a bit, you know, you lose your guard, you become a bit more, what should I say? What's the right word? So let me say that they were a bit, kind of things had become easy. The market was huge. The financial controls were not there, that many financial controls. Of course, we had great technical strengths, but marketing was still a weak link because you didn't have to do any marketing when you have got 70-odd% market share.
Yeah.
You just need to sell it to or distribute the your commercial vehicles or trucks to your dealers.
Yeah. So were you saying you were heading towards, you felt it was going towards complacency in some way?
Yeah, I think that's the right word. Complacency is the right word. And I do remember telling my colleagues, and in fact, I did tell Mr. Tata also in within 2 to 3 months that things are not so great here. And he gave me, as I said, free hand. He gave me the free hand in terms of, and as I said, it was a big canvas.
Yeah.
Wherever you touch, even in those days, to do anything, the figure would be at least 1 crore minimum.
Wow.
I mean, today, of course, 1 crore doesn't look to be that great.
Yeah.
But in those days, 1 crore was big money.
Significant.
Equipment. So we had very lax working capital management. We had big profit-making company, but huge debt on our balance sheet. So cost controls, cost optimization was not in anybody's dictionary.
Yeah.
So, and the processes with reference to capital expenditure and controls, again, was not really looked at it carefully. Return on capital employed was never the, or return on equity was never the
agenda.
Kind of agenda. So the basic financial controls and what you measure in terms of financial controls were very lax. And so I think for somebody like me, I would say it was with good background and good learning, I think it came as a very good ground to really implement what I thought was the right thing.
Mm.
And I must say, Mr. Tata was very supportive.
Mm.
You know, when you are getting into some companies like Tata Motors or Telco at that time, where change management is important, but is also very difficult.
True.
So you need to be very persistent. You need to be very, you know, not kind of a, what should I say, negated or get the feeling of, you know, losing something or getting defeated.
Yeah.
And this is something which I kind of, you asked me about what was my, one of the positive things was I never get disheartened.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I don't lose my confidence of doing the things.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, when somebody is very aggressive, I will withdraw step back.
Yeah.
And then, but never lose my focus.
Mm-hmm.
So that's something which I always learned, maybe by observing some of the senior people.
Mm-hmm.
And so persistence and not kind of giving up helped me a lot.
Okay.
And finally, whatever, you know, we needed to do finally happened.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe you also need some external shocks.
Yeah.
So in financial year 2001,
mm-hmm.
2001, the company made loss of 500 crores.
Mm-hmm.
It was a massive loss in those days.
Mm.
I remember the Economic Times editorial, the next day after we announced the loss, wrote an obituary of Tata Motors.
Wow.
And that editorial is still there, which talked about, you know, end of Tata Motors. And it said obituary.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the time when the pride of all the Tata Motors, you know, the people really felt, they all felt very hurt.
Mm.
That's the time it kind of, of course, we had already started the work, but you needed some shock.
Yeah.
And shock came in that loss of 500 crores in 2001.
Mm.
And I must say that everybody really, really worked together
mm-hmm.
in terms of whatever we are talking about, in terms of restructuring the operation, selling off the, you know, hiving off and selling off some of the businesses which did not make sense.
Yeah.
The working capital management I talked about, bringing the discipline in terms of capital expenditure management and so on and so forth. And that really helped a lot in terms of quickly turning around the situation. So within 18 months, in fact, less than 18,
mm-hmm.
we kind of started with less than 12 months, actually. We reported huge loss in March 2001. And last quarter of financial year 2001-2002, we had reported profits.
Wow.
And then since then, the company actually started going up. Of course, we always had the strength in terms of technology. Marketing division started really working like what a great organization should work in terms of selling and marketing. We had great products, and the company really made good progress. At the time of this loss, we were saying that we need to get into negative working capital. We had huge debt. We should get into a debt-free company. And that happened. Within 3 years, or less than 3 years, we actually made the company debt-free. And that helped us in giving the confidence of acquiring the Daewoo Truck company. As you know, the Daewoo Group, after the Asian crisis in late 90s, 97 to be precise, the currency crisis that happened, the Daewoo Group had collapsed. And they had a passenger vehicle business and they had the commercial vehicle business. And the creditors, all these Korean, South Korean creditors, created a kind of a consortium to sell off the assets and realize whatever they could realize from the proceeds of through the sale of assets. So the passenger vehicle business was bought over by General Motors, and we bought the truck company. This is basically the heavy truck company, and there's a place called Gunsan, which is about 200, I think, miles of south of Seoul in South Korea, and they were adjacent to each other, the passenger vehicle and but big kind of a campuses. So so we there were about 11 or 12 bidders, international bidders for the truck company, and nobody knew Tata Motors. And I remember the first time when we went to South Korea, of course, language was the big problem. There was a gentleman who was kind of allotted to us to interact with us right from the day one. He, in fact, asked us that, what do you do in India? Kind of a question. You know, we were the largest in the India, largest industrial house in India, but still this gentleman is asking us, what exactly is your business in India? And starting from there, you know, asking the basic questions about the group, about us. And but it was great, great experience of almost close to 10 months. And I think they liked their approach, liked our approach. You had to take the consent from the union. Because it's the union culture is very strong in South Korea. At least at that time, it was very strong. So we had to take their consent, and we kind of, and my colleague, Mr. Ravikant, who was the executive director of commercial vehicles, then he subsequently became the managing director of Tata Motors and then vice chairman. But I had moved out by then to start Tata Capital. So he and I worked together very extensively. And he kind of thought that we should prepare all our good labor policies that we have in the Tata Group and also in Tata Motors. We should convert them into pamphlets or material, printed material, video shootings, and convert them into Korean language and present it to the workers, to the management. And that became a great success. And the best part was, and which is the photograph is still shown many a times, that when we signed the agreement finally in 2004, March, I think, Mr. Tata came for the signature. He personally traveled to Gunsan. And after the signing ceremony was over, he had lunch with the workers in their canteen. And that photo became such a great success. I mean, great and kind of a favorite kind of photograph all over the world, and more particularly in Korea. And that helped us, or helped me in particular, when in Tata Capital, when we were raising the private equity money, a South Korean you know, sovereign fund called KIC, Korea Investment Corporation. So they decided to put $200 million in our fund. The reason being, because they knew about the success story. Then, of course, Daewoo Truck Company was making losses. We immediately converted into a profit-making company. And it helped Tata Motors a lot in terms of getting the technology for the heavy trucks, which is basically what you see in the rest of the world.
Yeah.
And so the sole success story had become a great feature in the Korean industry.
Mm-hmm.
So that helped us when I was raising money in Tata Capital for our funds,
okay,
private equity. So that was that. Then, of course, Mr. Tata always had felt that we should get listed on New York Stock Exchange. So when I first went to Tata Motors, I got transferred from Tata ABB in 96. So Mr. Tata had told me that we should get Tata Motor listed on, again, repeating his words, I would love to have Tata Motors listed on New York Stock Exchange.
Okay. The so message was conveyed.
So, and we wanted to do it earlier, but then this loss in 2001 kind of stopped us.
Mm-hmm.
But the message was very clear that we need to do it.
Yeah.
So when the company quickly turned around and we had to kind of, we were making good profits, we had acquired David Truck Company, we were getting the international attention.
Yeah.
So in 2004, we did the listing on the New York Stock Exchange.
Okay.
In between, of course, as a part of the restructuring, we had our IT department, which was called MSD, Management mm-hmm. System Department,
mm-hmm.
and our Management Systems Division, MSD, which was not only doing IT, but was also doing the engineering, the product development engineering work.
Okay.
And with all the computer engineers working there for the new trucks or the new vehicles of Tata Motors.
Mm-hmm.
And Mr. Tata felt, you know, because we were losing engineers, because this was treated as an automobile company. By then,
yeah.
Infosys had made a public issue.
Mm.
Software in India was getting a lot of attention.
Yeah. Yeah.
All the stock options and everything was becoming a popular buzzword. And that was not something which Tata Motors could do.
Mm.
So same thing. 97, Mr. Tata said, I would love to have a separate company. So we created this company called Tata Technologies,
okay,
with zero revenue, external revenue. Today, it is close to $500 million revenue.
Wow.
And then same thing we did with our construction equipment business,
mm-hmm.
which was as a part of a division. We created a separate, demerged, created a separate company, brought in Hitachi Construction Machinery as a joint venture partner.
Okay.
Both the companies, they have more than $1 billion valuation.
Oh.
They are not listed.
Hmm.
Hitachi, of course, first came in with 20% equity stake. And finally, when they came with 20 became 40, 40 became 60 in 2008-09.
Mm-hmm.
So when the equity, additional equity stake of 20%, they valued the company at $1 billion.
Okay.
So in way back in 2009. So from 19... So they came in 2000. In less than 9 years, the company was valued by them at more than $1 billion. So great experience, worked in, it was really fulfilling experience, like what you would like to do,
yeah,
and like to learn, like to really get delivered as a as an executive.
Yeah.
You know,
you always cherished. Kind
of, yeah. So the stint in Tata Motors was will always remain as a big fulfilling experience for me.
Okay.
Then, of course, 2006, actually, Mr. Tata told me that he would like to create, because by then the things were improving in terms of the banking sector. The liberalization was taking place.
Yeah.
And there were enough indications that Reserve Bank of India in particular and the government would like to see more private sector banks coming in,
mm-hmm.
and they will allow perhaps the big corporates to get into corporate, into banking.
Yeah.
So again, same happened. Mr. Tata talked to me about it.
He would love to get into banking, is it?
No, he said this is what it is. Tata should get banking. And this is an opportunity which is likely to come through. And I don't want to wait that opportunity to, or the Reserve Bank to make an announcement. Then we kind of start helter skelter. And I would rather prefer to make the beginning right now. So I was listening to him and he said, I would love to have you as the, no, he said, I would love to take this responsibility and become the managing director of the company.
Wow.
And at that time we had the, you know, the guru of finance, as we used to call him, Mr. Sunawala on the board of Tata Sons. He was the vice chairman. And Mr. Tata said, Noshir also feels the same way. And this was at London airport.
Okay.
Waiting for our flight from London to, we were traveling from New York to London and from London to Bombay. So at the London airport, he said, and he said, when you land in India, please go and see Noshir.
Okay.
So that's the message.
Very interesting.
So he said, yeah. you want to think about it, you can come back to me. I said, no, sir, I've taken a decision.
That's right.
I said, yes, I'll take the responsibility.
Very good. So yeah.
It took me less than a minute to convey my yes to him.
Okay.
And that's why the journey of Tata Capital started.
Okay.
In 2008, it actually happened 2 years later by the time I actually took over, because 2006, May, he told me. And then, so I was supposed to prepare the business plan and everything, which were finally presented to Tata Sons board in early 2007. Tata Sons board approved it. I was actually supposed to start in 2007 itself. And then the opportunity to acquire Jaguar Land Rover came. And so Mr. Tata said, I think you should complete this transaction. Then again, Mr. Ravikant by then had become the managing director. So we worked together very closely. And we got it. And but by then the situation was, had become very bad. If you remember 2008, early 2008, you know, there was this global financial crisis because of this whole,
You know, subprime crisis.
Subprime crisis, the fundraising, because we had to raise $3 billion. So for the acquisition, and we just had 3 months time, because in December 2007, Ford Motor, he told us that we have selected you, we are giving you exclusive, but we would like to see a letter from the bankers that they have arranged for the funds for you to the extent of $3 billion. So literally, and I was given the responsibility, because subsequently it was all the more like a technical stuff in terms of so completing the closure related to the you know, technical parts of the raw material supplies and so on and so forth, all of that, because it was a division. The Jaguar Land Rover was a separate company. It was a division of Ford Motor Company. So I was asked to kind of handle this matter, and along with one gentleman who then subsequently became, and is still, I think, the treasurer of Tata Motors. So single-handedly raising the money in the most during most difficult times of the international crisis.
Yeah,
we could raise $3 billion.
Wow.
And what I'm happy about the acquisitions, two major acquisitions. In between, there were some acquisitions, some sale of assets, sale of businesses. But what's more important about these two major acquisitions? One is, of course, the Daewoo Truck Company, and the other one is the Jaguar Land Rover.
Yeah.
Whatever valuation I arrived at in the beginning itself, when with a very limited data, because as you know, you have to first put the non-binding bid. And when you have the non-binding bid, I'm talking about in global acquisition scenario, when you have to put the non-binding bid, you are given very limited information about the company. And based on that, you have to put your bid with your valuation.
Ballpark,
So in both Daewoo Truck Company and in the case of Jaguar Land Rover, whatever price I worked out, and both the cases, it didn't even change by one single dollar.
Wow.
And with, so I really kind of, that I would say is my another happy moment, that my valuation turned out to be kind of didn't have to change at all in both the cases. Because after the first non-binding bid, if they find your pricing good, or acceptable, then they allow you to go through the data.
So
then you do the, you are given the access to the data room, you go through the data, technical, commercial, legal, accounting, whatever it is. So, and after the reviewing that massive data, then you are supposed to put your final bid. The final bid in both the cases was the same. We won the both these assets or businesses. And since then, both the acquisitions have turned out to be very successful acquisitions for Tata Motors. So that was, again, something which gave me a lot of personal satisfaction.
Absolutely.
The turnaround, making the company debt-free, raising the money in the international market, you know, billions of dollars, getting the company listed on New York Stock Exchange, significant cost reductions, which we did throughout, where, of course, some of these positive things I'm very happy about. But as I said, you know, the landmark acquisitions and giving the perfect valuation, which everybody, I mean, it was, I still remember when we were going to put our non-binding bid for acquisition of Jaguar Land Rover. And this was, even at that time, Jaguar Land Rover was much bigger than Tata Motors. If we had to put that bid, and if anything had gone wrong, it would have been a great disaster.
True.
So the valuation, I was asked to make a presentation to key directors of Tata Sons in the evening. It took 2 hours for making the presentation. Lots of questions were asked, scrutiny was made. But finally, the senior directors of Tata Sons, including Mr. Tata, who was there in the meeting, they all accepted. And that's really helped us in finally. I must say that there was a big criticism against Tata Motors that we paid higher price than what was really worth. But by then, after completion of the acquisition, I had moved out. But Mr. Ravi Kant and all the JLR team members in UK did a great, fantastic job.
Okay.
So from a loss-making business to a profit-making business, and whatever price we paid, $3 billion, many more times Tata Motors got back.
Absolutely. So, and the brand equity itself played such a huge, huge role, right? So, Mr. Kadle, apart from your corporate life, you have been very, very actively involved and even continue to in social sphere in terms of be it Child Relief and You or CRY, and even your own community institutions. Can you share a little bit about what has been your experience and what do you look forward from these institutions and the role they play in the development of India?
You know, the one basic theme of whatever I have been doing in the social sector is we all talk about, I mean, being an Indian, I'm very proud Indian citizen. I would really like to do something in my own small way to the growth of the country, whether it is the materialistic thing or non-materialistic thing. Whatever I can contribute, I would like to contribute. So that's the basic philosophical belief. The second thing is, you know, some of the initiatives you ask about, the strong belief that, you know, we all talk about the demographic dividend India has. But in my, it's my strong belief that this demographic dividend can become huge demographic liability unless we provide affordable healthcare, affordable education, and then employment or employability or entrepreneurship opportunities to the youth from the age of around. And if you don't do that, then you are going to have a big demographic liability. And that demographic you know, dividend is something which needs to be nurtured through these initiatives. And therefore, when I look at CRY, again, the same, it's basically child. It was child, really, you, now then they change it to child rights and you. And CRY has done huge amount of work in terms of right to education. They are not the, it was finally the act which was passed by the parliament. We did huge amount of work in terms of making it happen. Apart from really spending money from the donors who donated the money. And I've been associated with this cry from 2005 onwards. So it's almost now 16 years. Then the, some of the community, same thing, the original, the community originally comes from backward area. Now it's not backward, but originally it was a backward area from northern Karnataka. Education was a problem. The woman empowerment was a big, big problem. And therefore, our community, you know, under the guidance of a spiritual head of our community, and he, the spiritual head, chose these initiatives at right from the early years of his becoming the spiritual head. So he started these, you know, activities as a part of the charitable kind of a, under the charitable wing of our, you know, community initiative. So we have now got students who are close to 3,000 students across various schools which we have in Maharashtra and Karnataka, including kind of enabling the specially challenged children in terms of building their skill levels and making them, you know, honorable citizens in the country and making them learn and earn by doing the skill development. So that's one part. And of course, we are now taking more initiative in terms of expanding these activities. So in the next 2 years or 3 years, what we have today, the strength of around 2,800, 3,000 will become maybe 5,000 students. It's not just the getting the number added. What is important is giving the value-added education. You know, value-based education. And, you know, we have got a great heritage, great culture, and that needs to be kind of imbibed in the minds of young students at that age. So that's very important. And that's what we do. It's so much about religion or anything. It's more important is giving the right values to your, you know, young next generation citizens who are going to make the future of India much stronger. Women empowerment, as we know, is again another area where, you know, traditionally Indian women have been kind of not treated well, although they are the main backbone of our families and our society. And especially you can see this vast, you know, kind of a difference in rural areas where the women are treated very badly. And that's what we thought we should give them the right to live with respect by giving them opportunity to earn something. Today we have got, with all the initiatives that we have taken, we have now got close to or more than 1,000 families in that area where we operate, the northern part of Karnataka, where now they are self-sufficient, where their children could never go to school. They are now going not only to school, but even going to colleges, having degrees in different faculties, including engineering, so much so that some of the lady students are now working in some of the famous IT companies, including company like Infosys. So you get that satisfaction that whatever we are doing. And my role is more like whatever I learned, you know, over the years in working in corporate world, and whatever I have learned is to give that through the my administrative experience in supporting these initiatives. So, and also doing the fundraising for supporting these initiatives. So that gives me a lot of satisfaction. I enjoy more in terms of working in these initiatives.
So Mr. Praveen Kadle, I mean, an absolutely fantastic conversation with you in the last 1 hour, you know, right from your corporate experience, you know, you're literally from your day one with Garhwari, right up to Tata's, to your immense contribution that you're doing for the growth and development of the institutions, and also in eventually for the country. Of course, also would like to congratulate you on the Mumbai Ratna Award that you actually received, was conferred very recently. And of course, tons and tons of achievements that you have had over the years. Wishing you very, very, all the very best for your new private equity venture, which is Prachitas, through Prachitas Capital. And of course, very, very best also for your social development work, which is contributing so immensely for the development of India. Thank you so much for being joining us on The Sound of Money.
Thank you. Thank you. You know, I just wanted to tell you that whatever I've done is a very small contribution. The awards do not mean anything. What is important is the self-fulfilling experience and satisfaction. And in a small way, if I can contribute, it's great.
Absolutely.
And thanks for giving me this platform. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Karle. And well, with that, we come to the end of this episode, this exclusive episode with The Sound of Money with Mr. Praveen Karle. Thank you so much once again for joining us on, and of course, tune into our channel regularly. Well, stay safe is the message from all of us here at The Sound of Money. Thank you so much.
Sound of Money with Santosh Sirur.